A solar system is more than just panels. An essential part of it is a solar inverter. I'm Jason, and in this video, we're going to tell you how to choose a solar inverter for your home and then what to do with it afterwards. First, a few words about why you would need an inverter to begin with. Well, an inverter converts direct current from panels into alternating current that is safe for all the appliances in your house. It also interacts with the commercial grid and keeps track of your system's production. It's the most complicated part of a solar system and also the most vulnerable because of it. So it really makes sense to pick a good one. Now, when you choose an inverter, you have to consider the type of your system in relation to the grid. If your home is connected to the grid, well, you've got three options. The most popular one is a string inverter. It's inexpensive and it's simple. The only real downside of a string inverter is how badly it deals with shading sometimes. Now, let's say you have several panels that are connected to each other. This is a string. Now, when one panel gets shaded, well, the string inverter brings the production of every panel in a string down to the level of the worst one. Look, there are ways to go around it. For example, people add power optimizers to panels to make each one of them independent. Another way to solve the problem is to choose microinverters. A microinverter goes directly on top of a solar panel and converts the DC from the panel to AC on the spot. There are panels that come with pre-installed microinverters, and these are called AC modules. Since each panel has its own inverter, shading of one module doesn't affect the others. Microinverters are more efficient compared to string inverters, and they can last for up to 25 years, basically as long as a panel itself. The downside is that getting several microinverters ends up being more expensive than just a single string one. Besides, everything is on your roof, and if something breaks down, well, then it's harder to access the location. But overall, microinverters are a good alternative, and it's no surprise that they grow in popularity among homeowners. And what both a standard string inverter and microinverters can't do is support a DC battery. You can add an AC battery, such as the Tesla Powerwall, to your system, but if the battery requires direct current, well, then you're gonna need a hybrid inverter. Hybrid inverters are the most sophisticated type of inverters and therefore, as you can imagine, cost the most. Such an inverter can act both as a grid-tie inverter and an off-grid one. When there is a power outage, a standard string inverter just shuts down. It's a safety requirement. The grid must be free of current for workers to repair it. But this also means that you can't use energy from your solar panels during an outage. A hybrid inverter keeps the solar system running and switches your house to a battery support. Some hybrid inverters can also be programmed to draw the energy from the battery instead of using commercial electricity at peak rate hours. And that's called peak shaving. We've talked about it in our video about Tesla Powerwall. You go and click the link on the screen to watch it now. If your house is not connected to the grid, or you just don't use it, you would get an off-grid solar system. RV and boat systems, they'll fall into the off-grid category as well. For this configuration, you would need an off-grid inverter. Now, there are two types that are commonly used. The pure sine wave inverters, they produce cleaner and more reliable electricity, and the modified sine wave inverters, which are cheaper, but they can cause interference. For example, a radio may buzz a little when it's turned on. They're also not suitable for sensitive electronics such as medical equipment. The latest models of microinverters such as the Enphase IQ8 can also be used in off-grid and hybrid systems, but again, they can only support AC batteries. So, how do you size an inverter for your solar system? The capacity of an inverter is measured in watts, and it should match the total power output of your system. For example, if you have a 6 kW system, then the inverter should be rated for 6,000 watts. The array can be bigger, but if there is just too much power from your panels for the inverter to handle, it can start limiting the amount of energy that it converts, and this is called clipping. Every model is different, but on average, clipping starts when the array output is 50% higher than the inverter's capacity. You also don't want to install a solar inverter that's just too big for your system, because the inverter is going to be most efficient if it's running close to its overall capacity. Another thing that you should check is that the voltage and current that will come from your panels should not exceed safe levels for the inverter. you can go and find the maximum voltage and current input in every inverter's datasheet. If you're looking for microinverters, well, then it's much easier because the datasheet always specifies the panels that a microinverter is compatible with. An A1 solar stall calculator can help you size a system and suggest an inverter that will fit your installation. And you know what we'll do? We'll leave a link to that in the description below. So now what do you do with an inverter after you've bought it? Well, the installation is usually performed by professionals. You'll probably have someone from utility coming to connect your system to the grid. If you choose a string or hybrid inverter, you can prepare a spot for it beforehand. Unlike solar panels, an inverter doesn't want any sunlight at all. It needs a nice, dry place with clean air, probably a garage, although some inverters are rated for outdoor use. There shouldn't be anything flammable or producing heat nearby. Some companies suggest leaving at least 12 inches of clearance around the inverter because proper air circulation is really important. Sometimes an inverter comes with an app for your smartphone, which you can then use to track your system's production. I suggest that you go and set it up right after the installation is complete. Home inverters usually come with a warranty from 1 to 10 to 15 years. Some simple maintenance might prolong the lifespan of your device. Since it fears heat and the dust, well, you should definitely wipe the inverter clean every once in a while. Check the connections. Make sure that they are fixed tightly. Inverters have air intake filters, and after a while they can't get dirty. You can try to clean them yourself or just call in for a service. Modern inverters also use software which you might have to update. Microinverters are considered maintenance-free, but calling over an electrician for a checkup sometime won't hurt a bit. And that's it. That's all we have to say about choosing a home inverter. And we really do hope that this was useful. Let me know if we've missed anything else. Also, please feel free to ask questions and we'll definitely get back to you. Check out our free guide on saving money with solar energy, the calculator, our magazine, and of course, our socials. I'm Jason. See you next time. Bye-bye.